culturally in Utah, we tend to be, you know, a culture and a, you know, a group of people that we really feel like we would be there for somebody else if they needed help.
A kidnapping caught on video at a Utah convenience store on June 26th has now been viewed over 2 million times online. The woman seen in the video is now safe. The suspect, her former boyfriend, has been arrested. But many who've seen this video are just shocked, not just by the kidnapping, but by the apparent inaction by bystanders.
It really is chilling video to watch. So what would you have done? At Fox 13, we know complex issues have many different perspectives, and that's why we've launched our series of 360 reports, really looking at a story or an issue from all different angles. So this time, I asked a law enforcement expert and domestic violence victims advocates across the state to give us their perspectives.
Sometimes the safest thing one person can do is call 911.
Elizabeth Solis is with the Utah Domestic Violence Coalition.
I think it's easy, especially when we're watching it, to say, oh my gosh, I would have done this, I would have done that. When you're facing a crisis, what you think you would do and what you do are oftentimes two very different things.
This is the video she's talking about. At least three people standing next to their cars when a woman runs to one of them for help as a man chases after her. The video has no audio, but witnesses told police the woman was yelling for help. She gets on the ground and stays there for several seconds before the man she's trying to get away from picks her up and throws her over his shoulder. She fights to escape his grip as she is carried away in plain sight of witnesses.
We know the bystander effect is real, and it's depressing.
Kaylee Bronson Cook is with Canyon Creek Services, which addresses domestic and sexual violence in the greater Cedar City area. She says there's a term for what we see in the video.
The reason the bystander effect is so real is people think that they need to jump in and start doing CPR, or they need to jump in between someone about to punch somebody in the face. It does not need to be that extreme.
Those who've studied the bystander effect say the more witnesses there are, the less likely they are to do something. But if one person takes action, others are likely to join the effort.
How you do that safely is a very complex question.
She says a quick safety inventory could guide you in a similar situation, asking yourself things like, am I safe right now? Will I continue to be safe if I intervene? And can I get support from others?
Somebody calling the police is an act of bystander intervention. Just because they're not, you know, stepping in between this man or trying to pull this woman off of the man hypothetically doesn't mean that they're not doing something.
In this instance, information provided to police helped with the arrest.
There's a balance there as to how and when you intervene.
Retired Unified Deputy Police Chief Chris Bertram.
If you overreact in a situation like this, where we think it's a kidnapping, but it's just a prank, or it's a boyfriend and a girlfriend horsing around, and I react in, you know, maybe a way that, you know, in a way that I believe it's a kidnapping by using some type of force or even using deadly force, I'm going to be held responsibly, not just maybe civilly liable, but responsible from a criminal standpoint.
He says it's hard for a bystander to see the full picture, not really knowing the whole story.
You've also got to be very cautious in those situations.
There are examples of people intervening only to end up becoming victims themselves. According to charging documents, 34-year-old Melissa Wood was stabbed to death in the courtyard of her Murray apartment complex by a 16-year-old boy she was confronting over his use of racial slurs. The incident happened in broad daylight in front of children, a setting many would consider safer than the comings and goings of a gas station at night.
What are your thoughts when you see something like that?
I have so many mixed emotions when I watched it.
Shelley Hayrand is the Prevention and Education Director for CAPSA, Confronting Domestic Violence and Supporting Rape Recovery in Logan, covering Cache and Rich Counties.
9 out of 10 times, you're going to kick yourself for standing by if you don't help. There is a training for this kind of stuff. It's called upstanding. It's a training that our state developed.
The basics of upstanding include options like directing attention to the situation, delegating others to help, or creating a distraction.
You know, taking them somewhere else, saying, oh, hey, come out to my car, I want to show you this.
Those steps are best when used early on to diffuse potential danger and less effective once things escalate, like they did at the gas station.
I probably wouldn't have directly intervened or tried to distract because those weren't really options in that situation.
We have bystander blaming taking place. Reality is we should be asking why the individual who committed the abuse was committing the abuse.
Now, when we talk about domestic violence, we want to remind you there are resources out there to help if you or someone you know is a victim of domestic violence. You can always call the Domestic Violence Coalition. They are available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. The number right there on your screen is 1-800-897-5465. And of course, if you're in immediate danger, call 911. And if you're interested in the upstanding training, we've got links at fox13now.com.